your biology. So today we are going to start with the topic reproduction in flowering plants. So when we talk of a flowering plant, we should know what are the parts of a flowering plant. Like flower, when I talk of flower, it is a reproductive unit of the plant. Now the structure of flower, just look at the structure of flower here. The outermost whorl, I'm saying the outermost whorl is petal, which is brightly colored, and many petals together, that is collection of petal, is called corolla. When we go down below the flower, you have sepals, and these sepals are green in color. And we know the collection of many sepals together will be known as calyx. Below the sepal, you have a round body which is known as thalamus, on which the flower is born. Now, moving ahead, let us talk about the female part of a flower. Stigma, the topmost flower, style, and ovary. Now, stigma, style, and ovary, these three things together make a pistil. P-I-S-T-I-L, pistil, which you also call carpel. Now, collection of many carpels together is called gynoecium. So when we talk of gynoecium, we always say that it is a collection of carpel. And carpel, what is carpel? It is a stigma, style, ovary, along with ovules which are present inside the ovary. This line which you see in between is called placenta. The ovules are attached to this placenta and they take their nourishment from it. Now coming towards the male part of a flower, we have anther, which is a bilobed structure. Bilobed means two lobes together. And below that anther, every anther has a long stick-like structure called filament. So we can say anthers are supported by filaments. Now anther and filament is together known as stamen. And stamen, when we have many stamens together, that is collection of stamen, is called androecium. So androecium is the male part of a flower. Or we can say many stamens together, while gynoecium is the female part. Now, moving ahead, after the structure of a flower, now one more thing, when we say we hold a flower by a stalk, you call it stalk. When we hold a flower by a stalk, it is known as pedicel. So pedicel is a structure which will help a flower to hold. Okay. Now moving ahead, I'm going to tell you something about how the fertilization takes place. But before the fertilization comes into the process, we should know the structure of various parts. So first of all, we are going to talk about the structure of anther. Anther, as I have already told you, what is anther? Anther is a bilobed structure. If you see here, it is a bilobed structure. Like we have a structure given here. You can see one lobe is here, which will make a single compartment, and second lobe, which will make another compartment. When we count as pollen sacs, we have four pollen sacs. 1, 2, 3, and 4. So these pollen sacs, they contain pollen grains. Pollen grains are developed inside the pollen sacs, and pollen sacs are present inside the anther. Okay. Now, the filament, which I have already shown you in the flower, the filament is the base of the anther, which will provide the support. I hope the diagram is clear. These diagrams I'm going to send you through Pix also, if you need to go. Otherwise, the chapter will be sent you. I'll send you through the ebook. Now, moving ahead, let us see how the development of anther takes place. Now, which I mean to say, how the pollen grains are formed, you can say. Okay. Now, this diagram, as we see, it is a TS of anther. Now, what do you mean by TS? TS means transverse section. Transverse section means when you cut anything, like this. Like, suppose this is a khira, cucumber, and you're taking a slice of it like this. So it is transverse section. Whereas longitudinal, if we say LS, so which means longitudinal section comes when we split cucumber into two like this. So this we have taken a transverse section of anther. In this transverse section, when we see the, suppose I have taken a transverse section like this. Now, when we see the diagram, you can easily see that there is the outermost layer, which is called epidermis. Once again, let it be very clear. The outermost layer is epidermis. Below it is endodermis, which is also called endothecium. Endodermis or endothecium. And when we talk of these, layers, you can see the middle layers start from the inner side. The middle layers start from here. These are middle layers. Once again, I'll just repeat it because it was not clear, I suppose. This is epidermis. Then below the layer comes, which is endodermis. You also call this layer as endothecium. Then you come with the middle layers. These are the middle layers. Okay. Now, tapetum. The another layer which is inside the middle layer is called tapetum. Tapetum is very important to note down. Why? Because when pollen grains are developing, they draw their nourishment from tapetum, which means tapetum gives them food. That is, the nourishment is provided by tapetum to the developing pollen grains. Now, inside it, you can see these round ball-like structures. You call them microspore mother cell. We are calling them microspore mother cell. Why? Because one mother cell will give rise to multiple pollen grains. These mother cells will later on going to divide and they will give rise to pollen grains. This opening is called stomium. When the anther will dehisce means what? Burst. For example, once again, I'll show you the diagram. The line of dehiscence is being shown here. This line of dehiscence means that the anther is going to split into two from this side. So, this stomium is the place from where the anther is going to burst. And all the pollen grains are going to get liberated from here. Now, similar pattern is going to be in all those four directions. Now, when we see this structure, to know it better, we have a chart for this. So, a chart which goes like this. This is डेवलपमेंट ऑफ मेल गैमेटोफाइट और माइक्रोस्पोरांजिया. माइक्रोस्पोरांजिया मीन्स द एंथर एंड माइक्रोस्पोर्स मीन्स द पॉलन ग्रेन्स. नाउ द आर्केस्पोरियल सेल. सपोज आई से देर इज एंथर एंड द सेल्स आर नॉट बीन डिवाइडेड. सपोज लेट इट गो बैक वंस अगेन. हियर सपोज दिस इज द प्लेस. We have all the layers and there is one cell only. This cell is called archesporial cell, which will give rise to microspore mother cells later on. Have you understood? I am saying that this single cell is going to divide into the layers and the microspore mother cell. So let's see once again. Archesporial cell is going to divide into two, the primary parietal cells and primary sporogenous cells. As the name indicate, parietal is related to the periphery. Periphery means outside. Outside plus inside, that means two layers will be given out. The outer parietal cells will form parietal layers and the inner parietal cells will form the middle layers. So if we see, the outer parietal cell forms endothecium, which I told you it is endodermis also. And the inner parietal cells will form middle layers, which I have already shown you, and tapetum. And when we talk of primary sporogenous cells, these primary sporogenous cells, I told you, will get converted into microspore mother cell. And microspore mother cell will have meiosis in them, which means, meiosis means when the chromosome number gets differentiated with N, the N number of chromosomes. You have haploid condition here. Haploid in the sense we say when sex cells are formed. So here, after meiosis, the microspores are formed, which are also called pollen grains. So this is the proper graphical diagram through which you can learn that transverse section of anther. This is very important topic because when we have in paper, we generally have a question like this, ki how the development of anther takes place and how the pollen grains are formed. So this TS of anther is generally a very important diagram which always comes in the exams most of the time. Along with this, if you have this chart with you, it will become easy for you to revise and learn. As I said before also, I am going to give you all these pics separately so that you can include in your notes. So, till now, we'll just revise what we have done once again. We have done the structure of a flower, where we have studied about the four whorls of the flower. First whorl is corolla. Second whorl is calyx. Third whorl is gynoecium. And fourth whorl is androecium. After that, we have come to the development of the male gametophyte, that means the anther, how the anther is developed. So this was the diagram I told you, which we have taken in a transverse section, which was shown like this. I hope everyone has understood. And with this chart, it becomes clear that how the microspores are formed and the other layers which are present in the anther are formed. Moving ahead, now we have the different stages of microsporangium maturing into pollen grain. Now, how the formation of pollen grain takes place? A pollen grain, if I say, is a structure which is a microscopic structure But we need to know what is present inside the pollen grain. Till now, though, we have come to know that how anthers form pollen grains. But how does a pollen grain look like and how does this gets its development? So if you see, this is microspore tetrad when it is inside the anther. It gives rise to, suppose I talk of one single. This one single forms a nucleus here. Now this microscope with the nucleus and the outer two layers clearly shows that it is a development of a anther. Sorry, not anther, pollen grain. Now, see this diagram. Here we have two vacuoles on the top and the nucleus, as I've shown you here also. Moving ahead, these vacuoles combine to form a big, large vacuole, whereas the nucleus with the chromatin threads undergoes the process of meiosis. When meiosis takes place, the spindle fibers will form. This has been shown as a cell division sort of a diagram, which will give rise to two cells. One is vegetative cell and one is generative cell. So now this is a developmental stage of a pollen grain. A pollen grain which looks like having two cells. One is generative cell and one is vegetative cell. The outside structure is little rough, which will get developed into the outer layer called exine, and inner layer is called intine, which is little smooth. Moving ahead, see, this is the structure of a pollen grain. Take a very good look. The outer layer, which I told you, is little rough. Why it is rough? A question comes. Why exine is rough? Because it is made up of sporopollenin. This is a very tough substance which cannot break the exine. It can withstand the high temperatures, acids and all, everything. The exine will never rupture. It will only rupture by... Or we can say the exine will not rupture. We have a open space where exine is absent. Can you just see this portion? This is an open space where exine is absent. And you see, we call it a germ pore. Through this germ pore, we can easily see intine is being visible. Intine, which is a smooth layer, which is inside this one. This is intine. Now, as I told you before also, we have one vegetative cell and one generative cell along with the other organelles and cytoplasm inside the pollen grain. Now, what happens when this pollen grain falls on stigma? As we know that pollination is a process through which the pollen grains are being transferred from anther to stigma. This pollen grain, when reaches stigma, starts forming a pollen tube. Now, why does the pollen grain forms a pollen tube? Because, as I told you, there are certain places called germ pore. The tube will be formed by intine. From here, the intine will come out and the tube will be formed. To carry the male gametes inside so that they can reach to the female gametophyte. So this is how the tube is formed. If we talk of a diagram A, this is the structure of a pollen grain. You can see a generative nucleus here with a generative cell. And vegetative, which I told you, is also called a tube cell or a tube nucleus. Why it is called a tube cell or a tube nucleus? Because it gives rise to a pollen tube later on. Now, when we see the B diagram here, you can see this tube nucleus is getting shredded. Thoda sa disrupt hona shuru ho gaya ye. Ab ye tube nucleus, when going to get shredded, generative nucleus will get divide into two. Now see here, this diagram. Exon is here, the outer one. Intron is forming a pollen tube. And these two male gametes have come from where? They have come from generative nucleus. Because generative nucleus is going to divide between two to form two male gametes, whereas the tube nucleus has shredded throughout to form a pollen tube. So this is how the pollen tube is formed on stigma. Okay. Now I think we should move ahead. I'll show you something now. Now, children, we are going to take a topic, female gametophyte. Now, this was all for the male gametophyte. Male gametophyte means the anther, while the female gametophyte, which we are going to talk about right now, will be the ovule. Now, let's see how the female gametophyte is being formed. Now, this is the outer look of a female gametophyte, which is also known as ovule. If you remember in the previous diagram, I've already shown you inside the ovary there are ovules present. And these ovules are attached by the placenta through a stalk-like structure. Can you see this? These stalk-like structures are making ovule being attached by the placenta. Now, this stalk-like structure is this one. You call this stalk-like structure funicle. This is the main body of ovule. Where the main body gets attached to the funicle, that place is called hilum. The main body gets attached to the funicle, this point is called hilum. Now, you have the integuments. Integuments can be outer integument, inner integument here also. These are actually the processes or the structures which will cover the ovule from outside, means for protection. Now, this upper portion, now this is an anatropous ovule. You must know it also, anatropous ovule. Why we call it anatropous ovule? Because it is lying upside down. This ovule is only the one which will come in your exam. There are multiple types of ovule which I'll show you. See this picture. There are many ovules. Like when we talk of this one, you see this is the opening which I have drawn like this. No, this is the opening which is on the top. So the micropyle portion is on the top. But the diagram which I have drawn, the micropyle portion lies down. Abhi, I'm going to label that diagram. You'll come to know. This is another one. Chemilotropous, you call it. So, the micropyle is sideways. So, there are different types of ovules which are in the thing, structures. But in our course, we have only anatropous ovule. So, this is the anatropous ovule. Now, while labeling it, so we are going to label first this portion. The empty portion on the top is called chalaza. There we have tissue of parenchyma. This is all parenchyma tissue. Now, as the word indicate parenchyma, we always know parenchyma is a living tissue which will provide food to the part. So, parenchyma tissue is generally, we call it nucellus. This is nucellus which is made up of parenchymatic cells. This nucellus carries, we can draw cells like structure to show that this is a parenchymatous nucellus. Now, inside it, we have the place where the eggs will be there. Now, this upper portion I said chalaza, and this opening, see the opening between the two integuments, this is called micropyle. Micropyle is the opening, only opening in a seed. Why I'm calling it a seed? Because when the ovule matures or ripes, it is known as seed. Ovary becomes a fruit and ovule becomes a seed. So have you seen a rajma seed? You have micropyle here. When we talk of a gram seed, you have micropyle here. So these places are openings through which the water enters, through which the pollen tube enters, and which will provide fertilization to the seed. Now, this is the chalaza portion. This is, I said, the parenchymatous nucleus. Here we have three cells on the top and are called antipodal cells. So these are called antipodal cells. These antipodal cells, and below it, these antipodal cells are present near chalaza. And below, when I draw here, we will have two synergids and one big egg cell. So these two, they are synergids, and this one big is egg cell. In between, we have two more cells or nuclei, you can say, and these are called polar nuclei. Now, this is a rough sketch of an anatropous ovule which we are going to have in our studies. Now, once again, let's just revise it. This is anatropous ovule. The upper portion is called chalaza, which is little empty. Then we have a parenchymatous tissue supporting the egg apparatus. This parenchymatous tissue is called nucellus, which will provide nourishment to the developing apparatus. Outer side to the inner side, we have two integuments this side, two or maybe three sometimes. And here also integument. So you can call it outer integument, inner integument, which will give protection to the ovule. This is funicle. The funicle is a stalk-like structure which will attach ovule to the placenta, as been shown in the previous diagram. Hilum is the point where funicle gets attached to the main body of the ovule. Now, when we talk of egg apparatus, the upper cells, which are antipodal cells, three of them, they are present at chalazal end. Chalazal end means near chalaza. And three, out of which two are synergids, they are present near micropyle cell and micropylar end. And the egg cell is the bigger one, which is going to fertilize later on. These two cells or two nuclei are called polar nuclei. Why they are called polar nuclei, I'm going to talk to you in the next diagram. So this is overall an apparatus of eight nucleated structure. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 nucleated structure. An overall diagram of female gametophyte. Now, how does this female gametophyte develops? This is our next topic. Now, just see this diagram. Suppose I have taken this diagram upside, not upside down, but straight. See, the micropylar end is here, up, whereas chalazal end comes this side. Now, this is the nucellus, which I was talking of, parenchymatous cell. Now, how does these all cells develop? This we are going to talk now. There is one megaspore mother cell in between. Abhi the cells have not been divided. Inside the nucellus, the egg apparatus is being made and there is only one megaspore mother cell. This megaspore mother cell is going to combine and form, it's going to divide and form dyad. Dyad means the two parts. So, one is here and one is here. Later on, similarly, tetrad will be formed. Now, this tetrad consists of four cells. Now, these four cells are again going to split to form eight cells. So, through the chart, we are going to see this, how it happens. Now, see this chart. This is development of female gametophyte. Archegonial cell. I told you one single cell is there. That one single cell is in the micropylar region of the nucellus. This cell is going to divide into two. Primary parietal cell and primary sporogenous cell. As I told you before also, when we're talking of antha, the parietal cells will only form the parietal tissue, which means the layers, like integument is there, or maybe the body of the ovule. And the sporogenous cell is going to form, sporogenous cell is also called megaspore mother cell, which I have shown you in the diagram, this one. This is your megaspore mother cell. So, this cell is going to divide. This cell is going to divide by meiosis to form a linear tetrad of megaspore cell. Linear tetrad of megaspore cell. Now, linear tetrad means what? This is the diagram which shows a linear tetrad. Can you see this diagram? Now, this linear tetrad, after mitotic division means 2n number of chromosomes. It is not a reduction division, it is a developmental division, you can say, because the cells do, the nucleus do not get reduced. So, mitotic division, say we are going to get 8 nucleate embryo. So, this 8 nucleate embryo sac is now formed. Which will have what? They will have two polar nuclei, two synergids and one egg cell. At which place? This is at micropylar place. And three antipodal cells at chalazal place. So, this is the overall development of a female gametophyte. See children, learning through the charts or graphs become little easy. Why? Because you people can easily draw it also. You can, if you're not able to write, you can easily draw it and you can explain your views. So that the teacher comes to know that you know everything about the diagram which you have drawn.